The following program is a presentation of BaseNet Internet Television.
Hello and welcome to another Crashing Glass podcast. I'm Holly Hurley, your host, here as always with Jill Henley. Hiya, Jill.
Hiya.
I have a very special guest today.
Yes, we do. We are doing pet chicks today, talking about animal shelters and rescuing and adopting pets from shelters, and a little bit just in general about women and how they get passionate about this and are passionate about their pets. And so joining us from Knoxville, Tennessee, via the phone is Eden Spiridawis, and she has some great experience with pet adoption. Hi, E.
Hello.
Thanks for joining us today. And we just, I guess, wondering, I understand you have some experience with volunteering or working at an animal shelter. Would you share that with us first?
Sure, yes. It's a very important topic to me. I volunteered at an animal shelter in Charlotte, North Carolina, and I got to see kind of how the pets came in, what kind of the condition they were in, and sometimes how they're maybe dropped off not in the best condition, and how much shelters take those, help those pets get healthier and get adoptable. And I love animals, and probably most people that volunteer at a shelter do, and work at a shelter do, because it is kind of the last resort to an animal's life. If an animal is brought into a shelter, if they're not adopted, sometimes the other option is their life is ended. And when I volunteered at the shelter, I got to not so much see that part of it, but just even to see the room that lives are ended for the cats and dogs. And that just struck me as I just had to think about it. Like, an animal's life is taken here just because we have an overpopulation issue in our country and in the world of cats and dogs, domestic cats and dogs. So seeing that made me realize, I never as a person would adopt an animal from, a pet store or a breeder, because they are breeding, and a lot of pet stores get their animals from puppy mills or breeders, and we already have so many cats and dogs in this country that we don't need to be breeding more. So that is my experience of volunteering at a shelter, and it really hit home a lot.
Eden, I have an adopted pit bull that I got from people who specialize in that here in St. Louis, because there are so many of them that end up in shelters because of, so much bad publicity. And we actually adopted them from a group that specializes in them and tries to rescue them from shelters so they don't get euthanized, so they don't end up in a situation like that. And I would put to you, do you think their theory is that humans are the reason that this happens to dogs? And I was wondering what your thoughts are on that. Like you were saying, breeding, overpopulating. And of course, in the pit bull community, a lot of people feel that it's bad training, that you have owners who specifically train them to be very violent. And, and their theory, they say, save the pit bulls, euthanize the people who fight them or whatever, or who abuse them. And I was wondering, from your point of view, how responsible are the people in basically making the dogs go into the shelters?
Well, yes, I do see, and I like hearing about all the variety of breeding rescues there are, so that, if there happens to be a breeding rescue for a certain breed of dog, they specialize in trying to find the right homes for that type of dog. And those are getting more popular. I'm seeing more and more kinds of different types of breeds of dogs having those special groups. And I do think there is a lot of responsibility on the owner or adopter to learn more about their breed before they just go and adopt a dog at a shelter or with one of these rescues. Because you need to have a lot of, give a lot of thought to bringing a dog or cat into your home and adopting them. It's like another member of the family. You need to, learn more about the breed and think about how active the dog or cat needs to be. And if you're going to be able to, help them with, give that to them, how much room they may need inside or outside. And there's just a lot of questions or a lot of things you should think about before adopting a cat or dog, because I think that may be what sometimes happens. is a family adopts a cat or dog because, of course, children, you know, they love to have animals, but they maybe there isn't enough thought given into, does this fit our family or does this fit my lifestyle? And therefore, sometimes a lot of animals are, you know, given a little bit, given back to the shelter saying, you know, we can't handle this dog, it's gotten too big, and we live in an apartment, per se. And so there just should be some more thought given on the person adopting the animal to make sure that you're giving the animal, the dog or cat, a good chance to, you know, have a happy life in your home. And then, as you know, as far as I think that's one thing that we've done when I've adopted animals is to think about, you know, what you can do to get ready for a pet and prepare for it. If you have kids, I mean, there's lots of adoptable dogs and cats that are, you know, kid-friendly. So you can really cater to your lifestyle, and as long as you give it enough thought ahead of time, and there's always, you know, there's going to be a dog or a cat out there for you for sure, and they're such good parts of the family.
You can hear the passion and, you know, in your voice about this issue, and it's so great because I know that there are, like you said, there are so many domestic dogs and cats that are do not have homes. I just talked to an animal shelter this morning in local to me in Medfield, Massachusetts, and she was saying that there's this one kitty there that has been there just so long she can't figure out why hasn't been adopted, months and months and months. And it breaks your heart. Like Eden, you said that when you saw the room where they, I guess, get euthanized if they don't get adopted after a certain period of time. So I can hear how passionate it is. And I guess my question is, or I think, Holly, I was wondering, were you getting at that, why do you think that humans have caused this problem to begin with? You mean in the first place, meaning by mistreating different breeds, or giving pit bulls a misnomer? Is that what you were thinking?
Well, I definitely think there's a misnomer around pit bulls. And I know that some people don't feel that way, although statistically they are not as dangerous as many, many, many other breeds, including, in fact, like a Cocker Spaniel. I mean, they're very low on the list of dangerous dogs statistically. And I do have very passionate feelings about that, but obviously I'm an owner, so I'm going to be very naturally predisposed to that kind of information. But what I was thinking more of is that, you know, what Eden was sort of hinting at in her first, you know, when she was first talking about working at the shelter, that people are breeding dogs, they're breeding extra, you know, people... They always tell the story about, you know, wolves came to people way back in the day, and then now we breed these animals and then try to put them up for adoption. So we're basically creating, and then people don't get their dogs spayed or neutered, so then they breed more homeless dogs. And you have this situation in which animals are being created basically by human negligence and then need a place to be, is more sort of what I was wondering if she felt that, because it kind of sounded like, Eden, that was something you might be hinting at, is that, like, you know, people basically create all these pets and then there's no home for them, you know, or they don't have a home, or they're not willing to take responsibility for the ones they've created.
Yes, definitely. I mean, that's, I said I don't support breeders or puppy mills, and that's why I would definitely, as a pet owner, suggest people always look for your local shelter to adopt first and foremost, or your local pet rescue, because, yes, there's such an overpopulation problem, and it's kind of twofold as well, because I think it's obviously the breeders creating and breeding and making more animals that aren't possibly going to be adoptable, but then also not being a responsible pet owner and not getting your dog or cat spayed or neutered, because that's another reason that the population is getting so high. And that's one thing with a animal shelter, is when you do adopt, every time we've adopted, if they come in and they're not spayed or neutered, they get spayed or neutered at the animal shelter, and then you adopt them afterwards. So the animal shelter is helping the citizen or owner be a responsible citizen by spaying and neutering your pet that you're going to adopt. And so I think it's the pet population. I mean, it's something that so many people feel so strongly about, and there's so many organizations out there on the national level and the local level that just really try to promote spaying and neutering your pet. I don't think they have mobile veterinarians that come to you, but there's definitely resources out there for low cost. If it's something like a family's concerned about the cost, there's definitely at your local animal shelter the availability to get your cat or dog spayed or neutered at low cost. And so, yes, so I think it is the human at fault for creating this over pet population. So I feel like, you know, as other human responsible citizens, we should do something and help reduce that.
Actually, you know, you mentioned some really good things, Eden, about this being one of the benefits of adopting from a shelter. You know, obviously I had a really great experience adopting from a shelter. What are some of the other positives you would say, like adopting from the shelter, maybe the ones that you've worked with?
Well, they're such a good resource. They know animals and they know different breeds of dogs and cats well, so you could always, you know, ask them questions you may have. They're trustworthy, at least the ones I have dealt with. They're trustworthy, and they will be there for you if you have questions, and they are looking out for the animal first and foremost. I can remember a time when my husband and I adopted our dog now that's 10, and, you know, we were very excited about getting him, and we were pretty set up at home for him, but we hadn't figured out if, you know, when you get an animal and bring them home, you know, if you're not bringing them inside, you don't have a fenced-in backyard, how you make sure, you know, they don't just run away the first time you bring them home, because you're already in love with them because, you've already opened your heart to them. Well, I remember standing at the counter and kind of talking out loud to my husband, Bill, and just saying, well, we have a dog run that, or we have a dog house for them, for him, and then we can always, for the first few days till he gets used to our area, our home, kind of, you know, have a place and leash tie him so he doesn't run off. And the lady looked at me, and I mean, I'm an animal lover, if you can't hear it in my voice, and she said, can you sign right here where it says you're not going to have your dog tied up, you know, to a limited space that won't be able to run, even just for a few hours. They made us sign and make sure we weren't going to do that. So we installed a dog run within the first time before we brought him home, so that even for those first few days, our dog still had the ability to run, you know, from a tree to another tree a certain amount of yards. And so it wasn't just, you know, pegged to a stake and couldn't really move around and stuff. So they're always thinking about the best interests of the animal. And I just feel that, you know, they have always, sadly, in a sense, a good selection of animals, because there are so many that come in. So if you, whatever you're looking for a dog and cat, whatever breed, small, you know, to big, you probably can find it at your local animal shelter or pet rescue. And I just, again, feel, you know, it's my opinion not to go to pet stores, because a lot of those pet stores are being supplied by breeders and puppy mills. And not only are those breeders and puppy mills contributing to the overpopulation of pets, but also the conditions at puppy mills. And I'm a member of the National Humane Society, and I read the letters that I get sent about just the things they come about when they find these puppy mills and break them up, is the conditions that these animals are treated are just horrific. So,
Before we let you go, Eden, I just wondered how many, I know you did that volunteer work at the Charlotte, North Carolina shelter, and then how many pets total have you adopted so far?
Well, I just have to count out loud in my head. It's probably
you can name them all.
I think we've adopted 7, because 2 dogs and 5 cats.
Okay, so 7 total. Yeah.
Oh, well. I just said, oh, well.
Yeah, 7's pretty good. Well, that's great. I think, I mean, it's so nice to, like I said, I think this is a very passionate issue. And I think that women probably, I know a lot of women who do get involved with, you know, shelters and volunteering, because it is, you can make a difference. I think it's one of those, I kind of liken this a little bit to my, I mean, just go with me on this stretch here, but like to my ideas about recycling. You know, you feel some days you're like, I am such an avid recycler, but I'm like, okay, so I'm doing all this extra work and making sure every possible piece of my trash in my house gets recycled. But there's like hundreds of millions of billions of people that are not doing that. But I feel like, you know, this is a small difference, but it adds up. And I think that to jump back to, you know, to rescuing animals, it's the same idea. Like every pet you rescue any information that you pass along to other people, including on this podcast, might save another animal. So Eden, you'd probably agree with that.
Oh, definitely. Small measures by many go make big rewards, you know, big success. Yeah, make big differences, exactly. It doesn't matter, yeah, how small, it's still life you're saving. And there's other ways, if you aren't at the point in your life to adopt an animal, there's other ways to help animals and your local shelters. They always could use towels and supplies like that. Just check with them. They could always use, we've donated a lot of our kids' old stuffed animals because they like to have, you know, extra toys there. And there's a lot of opportunities, and so, you know, not just donating money to a shelter if you want to help make a difference, or adopting an animal, is to donate some of the goods and the needs that they need just for day-to-day function.
Oh, that's a great idea. You know, so towels, old toys, even, or, you know, stuffed animals, things they can chew on. Mm-hmm. If you're not at a point where you can adopt a pet right now. That's, you know, this is motivating me, because I'm going to visit the shelter in Medfield, Mass, because they have such a great shelter there, and their website, I'll give that website at the end of our podcast, but that has a lot of great links. Like Eden was mentioning, there's so many organizations. We all know about the Humane Society, which is a national organization, but Eden, I imagine there's so many local, local ones, town ones, as well as several other national organizations that you can check into.
Oh, definitely, definitely. And the things they probably list on their website that they could use. And always check with them before donating food, dog or cat food, because sometimes they have specifics for the pet's diet that they have. So just, you know, check with them. But, you know, any help helps. So.
Yeah, all great. Okay, Holly.
Can I ask, Eden, I don't know if you have time right before you go, but is there any advice you would give to people looking to adopt, people like Jill who are on the verge of their first adoption?
Definitely. I would say research. Start with some research about looking to see what type of animal will fit your lifestyle. You know, think about the size apartment or house that you have, and just what animal would fit your lifestyle the best, because if you make a good match, it'll probably be a long match with an animal, and they'll become part of the family. So, you know, if you have questions and just want to go and look around, sometimes going into the shelter gives some ideas of different breeds and type dogs and cats. But I would just say start with some research and thinking about what would fit your life the best.
That's great. Well, thank you. I know you're on the run, literally, almost. And so thank you so much for joining us by phone for the podcast. And that was great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you. So, you know, Jill, this is an interesting topic. You know, a lot of the research out right now, the APPA, the American I can't remember what the second P stands for, association, put out a study earlier this year, basically saying that, you know, pet ownership, despite the recession, is actually up right now. About 71% of Americans own pets.
Right. I know. I saw that statistic. And that's, you know, I think that's interesting, because it is, as Eden was mentioning, it has such a high reward. You know, you probably, if you do your homework and you, like she said, and you really think it through, it's low risk, high reward kind of thing, which is perfect for a recession.
Yeah, totally. I would agree with that 100%. And actually, I guess a lot of people agree with us, because this week on all the daytime television shows on ABC, they actually did a puppy day.
Oh, okay. Yeah, tell me a little bit more about that.
Well, they started their morning programming with the View, basically, and the View did like best mutt in show. You know, obviously, since it's around the time, you know, they're having Westminster and all that sort of stuff, this is the big time for that. And so they started with that, and then they went into on a couple of the other afternoon shows, The Chew, which I love, because it's all the celebrity chefs I like, and then the guy from What Not to Wear, so I love that show.
Right.
And on The Chew, they also brought in their puppies, and they did like best chews like for dogs. And then the afternoon on The Revolution, which is the guy from Extreme Home Makeover, you know, Ty, who's like adorable. They also had like, they basically brought on a doctor to talk about like the sort of health drawbacks of certain dog behavior. You know, like I'm the kind of person who like we sleep with our dog in the bed, and she talked a little bit about what the dangers are of that, which I think most most people typically say the biggest danger is they play outside and they could get ticks, and you can actually get ticks from your dog. So you want to like check them. You know, our dog doesn't have long hair and we don't live in a particularly rural area, so it's not a big problem for us. But, you know, I thought it was really interesting, and I wonder what the result will be as far as adoption is concerned for this sort of aggressive measure.
Right. Yeah. The aggressive measure, meaning kind of putting it all into the media.
Exactly, like putting 3 solid hours of television on just devoted to dog adoption. Like, I wonder if the adoption centers around the country are going to see just a huge uptick. It'll be interesting to talk to Eden maybe like next week and see if maybe she's been swamped, you know?
That's true. You know, I just want to throw out this one website too. It's www.medfieldshelter.com. And Medfield is spelled just like it sounds, M-E-D-F-I-E-L-D. So medfieldshelter.com. And it is one of those very comprehensive websites where it has its pictures of their adoptable pets and the hours you can come in. But it also has lots of like general information and links to other info. So, so it will be interesting. I'm going to be in there, actually, over the next week or so. So I will see what, you know, they have to say about that, because I think that it's interesting connecting to the recession, you know, that maybe this is a great way to, you know, just do something. Like, I know that when people get dogs more than cats, it's sort of like having, you know, it's kind of like having a child, you know, like especially when it's a young dog and you have to train it and you have to teach it things. And so it's funny that, you know, maybe more people are deciding to get dogs over having another kid.
There are actually some new statistics on that front as well, whereas like I can't remember the exacts on it, but we are much in like the 1950s, it was more common for households over 4 people to have a pet, because typically people got them, as you mentioned earlier, for the kids. You know, or like you and Eden were talking about that, like people say, oh, well, my kids really want a pet. And that Right. used to be really common. And that area still holds down about 30% of pet ownership. But in this day and age, the most frequent pet purchasers are actually young couples. Not to say that I'm so young, you know, but because that's not true. But, you know, John and I don't have children, and we got a dog, but we are not necessarily planning to have a kid. And they said a lot of people in recession era times, actually, most pet owners are spending more money on their pets, sort of out of guilt for not having other like things to do.
Well, that's okay. That's good for the pet.
Oh, it's very good for the pets and very good for the pet industry. So I think it's interesting because it's a different demographic these days. You know, most people are adopting dogs, actually, the statistics say, instead of having kids, just like you said.
Right. Well, that's so interesting. So in the 1950s, it was usually a family that already had 4 members, and then they'd adopt a dog and kind of add love to the household that way.
Well, you know, they actually mentioned, think Lassie was actually what the scientist who put forward the essay said in parentheses, think Lassie, like yes. Timmy and Lassie.
That's right, Timmy and Lassie. So to switch over, just to go back, or to go back to the pit bull question, so here's a quick, I don't know, not that it's that controversial, but, you know, so you, I know that people get passionate, not just about adopting animals, rescuing animals, but adopting a specific breed and pit bull. And I know I have another friend she's got her breed that is so dear to her heart. And it is one of the breeds similar to a pit bull where, you know, it doesn't have it has a bad rap a lot, you know, overall. So I respect that so much, because I do hear that pit bulls can make are incredible pets. And even when you do have small children in the house, or, you know, either way, they can be such loyal, loving pets. But to throw my wrench in, when I was 16, high school runner, track and field, you know, we'd run in cross country, we'd run outside every day after school, and I got attacked by a pit bull. But it was actually a bull mastiff. So I think that's related. And it was just a really, really, really bad experience for me. And I luckily came out with really small injuries, what could have happened, partly because there were other people around to help get him off of me, because he knocked me right down on the ground. Because he was a big 150-pound bull mastiff. No, actually, 100 and something pound bull mastiff. So I just wondered about that, about our pit bulls or that breed, because I was just running, like I was on the road, you know, I was like minding my own business. So I just wondered what, if you had anything to say about that breed and, or, you know, pit bull, bull mastiff, and just whether maybe they are, they have been bred obviously to be very loyal guard dogs. And I experienced that firsthand when I was jogging by with my high school teammates.
Well, that's actually a very interesting experience that you had. I mean, obviously that owner had trained that dog to be very vicious, and I've heard some people, you know, who have experiences like that. The interesting thing about pit bulls as a breed, and obviously different breeds and, you know, different instances of attack, you know, the number one dog that accounts for sending people to the emergency room is a Cocker Spaniel.
So this is your Cocker Spaniel on.
my Cocker Spaniel instance came from. But it's really interesting because the reason they have actually found, the people who actually do the legislation on this, that in every case that a pit bull, a Rottweiler, or the kind of dog that you were looking at, a bull mastiff, were involved, you know, these big dogs, German shepherds are also, people are always afraid of German shepherds for this reason, that there was actually gross human negligence involved. Okay. And these are, you know, they use German shepherds as dogs for, you know, military bomb sniffing, for, you know, for police dogs. And the only reason they actually don't use pit bulls is because, unfortunately, as you said, they have been bred to have very strong jaws.
Oh.
So you know how you see them training German shepherds to hold on to things and not let go? Well, pit bull bites about 10 times stronger. So they're just, you couldn't use them to train in that way. You wouldn't want to teach them to do that because their bite is so strong. And of course, you know, responsible owners would never, pit bulls are actually very difficult to train to be violent, but they're very easy to train overall, which is why people choose to do that. They're one of the smarter breeds, all that sort of thing. And they're very, as you said, very loyal to their people. But with that comes the fact they're very easy to train, which means they're very easy to train to be good dogs. You know, all of Michael Vick's dogs were acclimated to homes, and a lot of them homes with children, within like 9 months. It's really that easy. Very easy dogs to train. And the unfortunate thing, and this is something that, you know, Eden was talking about, is that people mistreat their animals sometimes because they either misuse them, as obviously the owner who had taught his dog to attack people did. And I've also been a runner, and I can tell you I've come along some very, very scary dogs on the road. And it's really frightening and unfortunate but you know, it's not the same world these days. Fortunately, there's lots of legislation to keep people from being bad dog owners, which, right, I think when I were younger just didn't exist.
That's a great point. In my town now, my town that, not my hometown, but my, you know, my new town, it is amazing when it's such a difference because there is a leash law here. And there was not a leash law when I was growing up in our town. And I can't speak to whether that hometown has one now or not. But I remember my parents, who were also runners, being very frustrated with the lack of leash law so in that town. So I'll have to look that up just out of curiosity. It's Chepachet, Rhode Island. I'd like to know if that's changed, because that's a great example for where government can really, you know, can make a difference. And I mean, there's, you know, not to go political here, but that government, a lot of people, you know, don't like too much government involvement and too many rules, you know, but that's a great example where I don't have to worry about my kids biking around the block in my town now that they're going to get, you know, some dog's going to nip them on the ankle because they're biking by their house, you know, where the dog lives.
Well, and it's unfortunate, too, because, you know, the government, a lot of people, instead of saying more leash laws or, you know, as Eden was talking about, instead of enacting laws that require dogs to be neutered, because 92% of fatal dog attacks and 94% of all dog attacks are actually enacted by dogs, male dogs, that have not been neutered.
Okay, so that's huge. That's like, so there you go. Right there that would solve a lot of problems.
Exactly. I mean, as far as like statistics and government involvement is concerned, it's unfortunate because a lot of people have turned to breed-specific legislation and said, oh, don't have German Shepherds or don't have Pit Bulls or don't have these certain kinds of dogs. But it's not the fault of the kind of dog. It actually is the fault of, you know, the fact that the dog's not neutered or the fact the dog's not on a leash, you know, that's really typically more the problem. And it's really unfortunate and very scary. And a lot of them happen to children because obviously as adults, we're naturally very cautious around other species. We've learned how to approach dogs we don't know. But a small child perhaps is not so smart. You know, they will run at an unknown dog in a way that may be seen as aggression to the dog. And if this is somebody's unneutered, unleashed dog, you don't know how it's going to react to that.
Right. You know? Yeah, so the onus is on the owner for spaying and neutering. And I thought that I love that when we are able to, like, take an issue, and I think we've done this, you know, at times we've done this well on the Crash and Glass podcast, and we take an issue, but we sort of back up or get underneath it and sort of look at it from that, I don't know, a different angle that almost goes back in time and examines the history of it. And I think when you mentioned that about when people started breeding wolves, you know, wolves were not always, you know, they still are, but they're wild animals originally. And then slowly became domesticated and evolved towards the domesticated dogs that we have now. And so, yes, we did create, humans are responsible for the overpopulation of animals in shelters. And I just love the fact that people like Eden and then many other people that I know who do give their time, and not just time, but resources, you know, like, to help that out, help their cause, donating. I'm going to, when I go into the Medfield shelter, just to check it out, I'm going to bring some, I'll call ahead, but I'm going to just bring some stuff that they may need. You know, I'll look at their website and see what they may need. Cause it just, I mean, what a nice cause, and what, like, you know, those small differences that you could make that can add up to really impacting, helping to impact the problem in a positive way.
Well, and I'm also really glad that these kinds of shelters exist for a number of reasons, but one of which is the fact that some people are not ready to own dogs. You know, I know we were in a building that didn't allow it at the time when we first got married, and also I wasn't sure that I would be a very good pet owner. You know, I counted on my husband, who has a lot of experience working with animals, for that. And so I actually didn't right at first feel like I was ready. And I think it's important that these places exist because they are, you know, as Eden said, very choosy about who they let adopt a dog. You know, there are special places you have to sign to ensure that you won't do certain things. They make sure the dogs are spayed and neutered. They inform you of any medical history the dog has. And I'm so glad they exist because I do think that adoption, just like an adoption of a human child, is not something that should be gone into lightly. And an adoption of an animal is not something that should be gone into lightly either, you know?
Right. Yep. Agreed. And this is, you know, there's just so many people that give a lot of time to this issue. And I did speak to a woman on the phone today who is the animal control officer for Medfield, and she was going to join us in the podcast, but she has 12 dogs that have to be walked between, you know, 5 and 7 tonight, you know, and she just says, I'm not going to be able to do it because I also have to cook dinner for my, at my house. So, you know, it's, she really does have a job that never stops. And I just give so much admiration to people who really put a lot into this topic.
Well, and I'd like to take the opportunity too, you know, if you are someone who's interested in adopting a dog, depending on what city you're in, you know, one of my friends who will be on future versions of this podcast, undoubtedly, because as far as working with animals goes, she is very, very accomplished. She's a certified professional dog trainer working in the Los Angeles area. She works for the APDT there, and she's worked for the ASPCA as well, and for the San Francisco SPCA as well. And so obviously you can look for the ASPCAs in your areas. I know in Massachusetts, the Angel MSPCA is really good. Here in St. Louis, we have wonderful adoption organizations, the Humane Society, et cetera. If you're interested in, you know, pit bulls are about 30% of the dogs that are homeless and need to be adopted, obviously because of some of the unfortunate and unfair media around them. Then the place here is called Phoenix Pack, or they used to be Mutts and Stuff. You can find them on Facebook or online.
Mutts and Stuff is very cute.
Isn't that cute?
Yeah. Is that a website that you said that's more of a local one?
Well, Mutts and Stuff is actually the name that Phoenix Pack used to go to. They actually began specializing in pit bulls when they realized that 30% of the dogs that were being brought to them were pit bulls, and that this was a breed that was specifically being maligned, basically, and, you know, unjustifiably. And so they basically devoted themselves to giving a no-kill shelter to very domesticated pit bulls. I mean, obviously, like everyone else, they believe there are some dogs you can't rehab. But for the dogs that are wonderful dogs, like Teddy, my dog, they give wonderful homes to them. So, you know, obviously look for the no-kill shelters in your area. Look for the ASPCAs. Look for the humane societies, and they'll be able to point you towards responsible dog ownership. And, you know, look up my friend Anamika Farrow if you have time. She's a certified dog trainer, and she's a wonderful woman in the industry who's top of her game. So, and we will have her on in the future. Don't worry.
And she's, you said she's based in LA.
She is. She's in the LA area, but she's very talented and obviously has all of her information on her website so that you can reach her if you have any questions or if there's anything that she can, you know, obviously, or if you are in that area and you're looking for a trainer, you know, she's exceptional. So I can vouch for her.
So it's the American Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals. Nice. Which is the P is prevention, which is great. Yeah. And then there's also the Humane Society, right? Is the other main national organization. So those are great. I love being able to learn about something new that, you know, I haven't really looked into this so much. And so because we were planned to do this as our issue of the week, I love it that I can kind of get involved a little bit because I grew up as an animal lover. Lots of animals around growing up at my house. So, and now I don't have a dog, a rescue dog yet, but I do have one cat who is from a farm that they were giving away because they had a litter that they needed, you know, they needed to give those kittens away. So last summer we got our first pet for our house. And talk about bringing, to kind of wrap this, you know, to go back to, and I think Eden really did a great job at giving us the big picture about pet adoption, that they bring so much love into your home. I mean, we didn't have this kitty, and then we got her, and now she's just, you know, she provides us with so much. It's such a high reward. She gives us, she makes us smile, she makes us laugh, and she's just a cat.
Well, and hopefully, I mean, eventually, obviously, this is sort of the more emotional take on the subject, but we can always have, you know, some, if you want to write in, if you're a passionate pet owner, please write in crashingglass@basenettv.com, I believe. And please write in, give us your suggestions. Feel free to donate to the show. Obviously, keep it going. Nice, strong woman number that we have going here. But, you know, I mean, for me, I can definitely say adopting Teddy has brought a ton of love in my house, and he is definitely the apple of our eye. You know, my friends make fun of me because I am like an overbearing mother for my dog. I'm constantly, well, you know, Teddy has anxiety and we have to be careful, or Teddy has gluten allergies, so we have to be careful, you know, and they always make fun of me. But the truth is that he has brought so much love into our house, and he is, people say, you know, your pets are motivation to exercise. The statistics are, you know, overall households with pets are healthier, especially dogs, are healthier on average than those who aren't, you know. And so there are also health benefits into bringing a pet into your house. And the earlier statistic I gave was from the American Pet Products Association. So,
your helicopter parenting your rescue pit bull.
I'm a helicopter parent for my rescue pit bull.
Well, that was great. So, well, I'm so glad. I'm so glad we were able to have Eden as our guest via the phone while she was doing her busy evening. So, Holly, what do we have headlining in Chick News this week?
Well, obviously in Chick News, Whitney Houston's funeral was this weekend. I mean, if we wanted to do Chick Pet News, I mean, obviously he's not a chick, but if we wanted to do Pet News, obviously Uggy was on The View this week. And Uggy is the adorable little dog from The Artist. And he was on The View this week and on many other talk shows. And a lot of people, there's a lot of Oscar buzz around him and how they feel like they should have created a special category because his acting was so extraordinary.
I did hear the buzz about that because wasn't there another time in the past where there was an animal that should have been, you know, that should have been up for contention as well, going back a little ways in Oscar history?
Ooh, I don't know, actually. I would love to find that out.
Okay. Well, I just remember hearing a little Oscar buzz about Uggie and how, and really from the actors about how amazing he was to work with. You know, the actors were, you know, they were just really mesmerized by him.
Yeah, no, I think that is definitely the buzz about him. And I think everybody, you know, online and definitely in the film community is sort of asking the question, you know, that people are saying actually that not only do they want like Uggie the dog to get an Oscar, but, you know, Andy Serkis, who played Gollum in the, or who did all of the motion capture acting for Gollum in the Lord of the Rings film. I mean, he was unbelievable. I'm one of those big nerds who watched like all 18 hours of footage. But they think that he should win for even playing an animal. And, you know, even on like IndieWire.com, they're saying like even the warhorse from Warhorse, you know, they could nominate. And so, I mean, I see the argument. I don't know. What do you think? Do you think there should be Oscars for animals?
Well, the problem there is that the trainer is the one that, the human is the one who's really like, kind of taking the direction and then making it happen. So I don't know. I'm up in the air on that one. I think that the trainers would, it would almost be that the trainers would have to have some sort of category of their own.
I think that would be a wonderful idea. Because, you know, that's the reason they include, like, best script is so that the writers get a shout-out. Right. Or, you know, they do best director because you don't see the director on screen. I almost feel like doing best animal performance might be a way for these animal trainers to accrue their own Oscars, which maybe I think some of them probably deserve, you know, because, you know, if you think about certain movies that you've seen, you know, the animal in that movie sometimes just breaks your heart and really, you know, endears you to the film.
Yes. Well, this is a Jack Russell Terrier, I guess, that Uggie and the artist. And then he was also in Water for Elephants. Awesome movie and book, as Queenie, which Queenie was the clown's little dog, right? And so he has, the Jack Russell Terrier, has gotten two nominations for Best Dog in a Theatrical Film, which was announced as the Golden Collar Awards. The Golden Globes, but the Golden Collar Awards. So that's great. I mean, there's some recognition there, which is well-deserved.
I agree completely. I would love to, you know, talking about Oscars with you, I would love to think, is there anybody you're rooting for, you know, Oscar ceremony, anything that you like to see this coming week?
Yeah, because we're a week away, right, from the big night. And our next podcast will be about the Oscars and not just red carpet glamour, that'll be abounding, but also talking about the Oscars themselves. I would say that I recently saw The Descendants. I did see it after the Golden Globes, so I know that George Clooney won the best actor he won a Golden Globe for best actor for The Descendants. So what I'll say about him is that I do like him a lot, and I feel like he's, you know, he can push himself. He's been in like Syriana is one example of a movie where he was, you know, not playing the stereotypical suave, handsome George Clooney. he was kind of an overweight, you know, kind of Middle Eastern correspondent, and it was a different type of role for him. But watching him in The Descendants, it was a vulnerability in his acting that was really cool. And I can see why he won the Golden Globe now. So I am pulling for him because I thought that not only was it a great movie, but it was a great performance by George Clooney.
I mean, I could support that. I haven't seen it, but the trailers I've seen, to me, it's almost like, oh, wah, wah, there's George Clooney again. You know, I'm kind of sick of seeing him on the Oscars. I don't know. I'm just sick of him. I'm sick of him showing up in his suit, and everybody's like, wow, doesn't George Clooney look good? And I'm like, how hard is that? He shows up in the same suit to, like, everything. I don't know.
Different girlfriend, though.
girlfriend, but the same suit. And what does that say? I don't know.
So I would have felt that same way probably until I saw The Descendants and saw that he really didn't play that suave, together, self-assured guy. He was the guy who was a mess, it was just a very interesting role. So you'll have to, we'll have to see what happens with that.
All right. I will concede to that if you will play a little good, bad, and different with me around The Help.
Okay. I can do that.
All right.
I haven't seen The Help, so that's
have you read the book?
I have.
Okay, it is basically the same, I can say. I think they did an excellent job in translation. So I guess we'll do it based around you can comment on the book, I'll comment on the movie. Help, good, bad, or indifferent, and why. You can pick different parts too to feel good, bad, or indifferent about.
Okay, well, you go first.
Okay, all right. That's fair. I did pose the question. So okay, The Help as a movie, number one, bad, Hilly Holbrook was not fat and she was supposed to be fat.
Okay.
I was upset about that. Bryce Dallas Howard is beautiful, and I never for one second believed that she could be as repellent as the real Hilly Holbrook. Second, Emma Stone, too pretty to play Skeeter. I would have liked to see someone more average in that role, quite frankly. But also, I would like to say my only problem with The Help is the same reason that I love The Help. Mm-hmm. Having grown up in the South, obviously, we are unfortunately rather behind the times, racially, I feel. And I know a lot of my friends who left Texas actually feel that same way. I was very conflicted because I felt like I had grown up with someone in the house very similar to what Skeeter had, and I always felt like she was as much my mother as my real mother was.
I know you mentioned that before, Holly. That's so interesting.
And I think you and I actually got to talk about this with Ashley, the fashion designer, Ashley Ellaby, when she was on. Right. I wish in some ways that this story had been told because the African-American community is getting around it and really supporting it. I almost wish that it had been, for that reason, told from their perspective more.
Versus here.
Exactly. But I do think that they did a beautiful job of translating it. And, you know, aside from my two minor little problems with it, I think that story needed to be told in that way, because there are a lot of us who have very conflicting, beautiful, rich feelings about these people in our lives who were not technically our family, but were so much more. And I think the story needed to be told, but I have to say, I think The Help was a good thing, but I worry about it as like, I don't know if it was a best picture. I don't know if everybody can enjoy it the way that I can and the way that the people who've been involved in complex situations can. So that's right.
Well, that's great. Well, you know, Minnie Jackson was, that Minnie was my favorite character in the book. I guess what I'll say about sort of the whole idea of it is that it's hard for me to even imagine a household where, you know, you become so close to The Help because I do not have any Southern experience, you know. So when you had mentioned that, I just thought that was so interesting that in being a mom now and knowing like how I run the house and sort of how that goes, it's just fascinating to think that of the differences there, you know, not just the racial, you know, the racial stuff, the issues that it brings up, but also the mothering and the idea of the kids having a household where, you know, you have like a lot of hands and a lot of opinions all coming in at once. Like, that's what I'm trying to say.
So you think it's interesting to you that somebody else would have impact on how your children are raised?
Yeah, or that much impact, you know, because school has, you go going to school every day once the kids are that age has a huge impact, but not, they still, it's still, you know, the hours, it's still shown that, you know, home is where you really learn a lot of those deep-rooted things that you carry with you, for good or for bad. So it's very foreign to me to think of having, you know, live in help and to have that kind of, like you said, that effect on raising the children, because raising the children is, you know, entirely mine and my husband's responsibility, you know, and I have the most time on task because I am home part-time and, you know, working part-time, but I just find, so it's very foreign, but fascinating, and which is why it was a great read.
Well, I think that's true. And I think it's a very intimate thing that you're talking about. And I think, I mean, I definitely think my sister, for one, you know, hires full-time help. And I've been a nanny for a family before. And I think it is exactly what you're talking about. It's kind of interesting to think about how much impact that person has. I mean, literally like a second mother. I'd love to talk to some of the, as you will, the help on the show. I think that would be a fascinating show, actually. Let's move on a little bit, and let's talk a little bit about Best Actress in a Leading Role.
Okay.
Glenn Close is nominated for playing Albert Nobbs, who obviously is, it's a drag role. She's playing, I don't know if she's playing a woman playing a man or she's just playing a man, but good, bad, or indifferent?
Good. I think that I just read a little snippet about this, and I don't know, right? Is she playing a man or is she playing a woman that is acting like a man? I'm not sure.
Get up.
When?
I'm gonna look it up while you're talking.
Okay. But Glenn, I did read, you know, she was just phenomenal at when she got into that role. I saw a picture of her, you know, in her drag. So to speak. And it was one of her great quotes about it was that she, I guess her husband, you know, just thought that it was so interesting that she could look so masculine. It was almost, you know, he was taken aback a little bit that she was so good at it. And that, you know, she was joking that, you know, that it showed another side of her and that, you know, that he had to get used to. So, cause she would come home dressed all, you know, dressed all in her manly stuff.
I actually think that is really interesting. I did look up, the film is about a woman who dresses as a man in late 19th century Ireland, so that she can be more independent. She actually takes a job as a butler. And then of course she falls in love and then she wants to not live a lie anymore. And I am amazed. I've seen a lot of photos of her in this role and I'm amazed because I've met her in person and she is beautiful. Well, I've seen her. It's not like she would remember it. We like ran into each other at a Whole Foods and I went and she put her sunglasses back on. You know what I mean? But she glows. She just, I mean, from the inside out is probably like, you know, looks like it's coming from inside of her. Her skin looks so good, you know? She's so beautiful. To see this photo of her looking essentially like my grandfather in his later years is shocking. But yeah. I mean, I always think pants rolls are good because I think women are more or less in a pants roll in this day and age. So I got to support that. But I don't know if it's going to be. I mean, I think the Oscars are in the habit on occasion of giving women Oscars for uglying up, if you will.
Right. Yeah.
I'm never against Glenn Close winning an Oscar because I think she's extraordinary. But I am against Oscars for great makeup that then get applied to actresses. You know, so I don't know. We'll see. And I have to say, as far as Rooney Mara is concerned, I believe that the original Girl with the Dragon Tattoo is the Girl with the Dragon Tattoo. I liked Naomi Rapace much more. I thought she was much more the character. And I think that this is more a shout out to people who liked the novels than it is the actual movie or her as an actress.
Okay. Well, there's an opinion for you.
Sorry, I'm very strong about
I was trying to go back to see. Okay, that's right. Meryl, so speaking of, I knew there was some circle back. I want to do just about the giving awards to women in a pant, like you said, in the pants role. Although this woman did not wear pants very much, but the Iron Lady, Margaret Thatcher, she wore skirts, but she was tough as nails. And Meryl Streep played her, I saw that movie, and Meryl Streep was, looking like an old lady, you know, because it really did focus on the end of Margaret Thatcher's life. So she was much older and much more frail and much had a lot of dementia, versus what we remember her as the prime minister. So I think that's interesting because that's a kind of similar in a way to Glenn Close's character, you know, the role that Glenn Close is up for best actress. So it'll be interesting to see what happens with that.
I'm curious about it, and I actually haven't seen the movie, so I'm kind of glad that you have. I think that's pretty cool. But moving on to actress in a supporting role, if that's cool, or do you want to talk some more about?
No, I'm good. We can move on to that. Let's cover those categories of actors, and then also talk about Best Picture before we're done.
Oh, that sounds great. I have to say, I love I love seeing Bérénice Bejot on the red carpet. I think she's beautiful. I think she's fabulous. But I'm rooting for Melissa McCarthy because I think Bridesmaids was truly an innovation as far as comedy is concerned. I don't think we've ever seen anything like that from women comedians. And I think she specifically gave a fantastic performance. It's so different from who she is. It's so different from anybody I've ever seen on screen really depicted well before. And I just loved her. I'm rooting for Melissa McCarthy, I'll say.
Okay. I haven't seen that movie, so I can't really comment. But
what? How can you not have seen Bridesmaids?
I know. I have not seen Bridesmaids. But I'm going to – I do like Bérénice. Of course, Bejot, she said she's very glamorous. But I do – I think I might be rooting for Octavia Spencer.
Oh, you and all of Hollywood, man. You just love Minnie. I think that's what it is. You're just pretty perfect because you love Minnie.
She was my favorite. So for Best Actor now, we've got, let's see, you probably have them on the top of your head. Well, we've got George Clooney. We already covered him. So I get maybe we don't need to cover this again. Oh, you have to tell us who you think. We've got Brad Pitt in Moneyball. We've got Gary Oldman, Tinker Tailor, Soldier Spy. I did not see that. Then we've got, the Jean Dujardin and The Artist. Oh, God, he is hilarious. I love just listening to him speak.
I love listening to him speak, but I'm sorry. I'm sick of The Artist, and this will apply for Best Picture category. I don't want to see it win any more awards this year. I get it. It's neat that it was a silent film. That doesn't mean it was the absolute best picture ever made this year. I haven't seen it yet, so I can't speak to it as like a standalone piece. Maybe it was the best movie ever made. But maybe it was just a great love story, you know? I don't know. I don't know.
I'm pulling for Clooney here. I know that's so not your favorite. And so how about Best Supporting Actors? I haven't really thought about too much about those. Do you have someone that you're pulling for?
Well, I'm a little torn. I mean, for Best Actor, I'm like Gary Oldman all the way. I think Oldman needs to win it. I just love him. But for supporting, I did see Moneyball, and I thought Jonah Hill was fantastic in that role. Okay. I don't know how hard a role that was to play, though. And I always loved Kenneth Branagh, and I think he's one of the best actors in the world. And I think us here in America have just been slow to accept him as the force that he is, even though he's been in numerous things and just blown it out of the water. He disappears in every role. He was the best Hamlet, bar none, I will say without blushing. And I would love to see him take one of these home just so that for once America has to look at him and say, yes, this guy is unbelievable.
Okay, well, that's good. That's a great. You feel strongly about that, Holly. I haven't seen all of the ones the movies for the Best Supporting Actor, but one of the ones who is up is the little boy Max. His name is Max von. The actor's name is Max von Sydow, and he's in Extremely Loud and Incredibly Close. So he's Tom Hanks's son, right? And so he is a potential spoiler for the Best Supporting Actor this year.
Highly probable. That is probable. Although I'm sure that kid is wonderful, but I think that movie does not need to exist.
Oh, really? Yeah. I actually have not seen it. So I mean, I've wanted to. What do you have to say about Extremely Loud and Incredibly Close?
Well, I will not go see it, actually, on principle. I think I understand why someone needed to write that story. I don't understand why we all have to watch it, but I have very strong feelings post September 11th. I was in New York at the time. I don't like the constant always remember. I think that's exactly what the terrorists want us to do. I think the more important thing to do is remember the lives of these people, which I think the movie's supposed to be about, but don't include. I just am anti any movie including September 11th as a plot point because I just feel that it's wrong. I have very strong feelings about this. Someone who lived through it, I don't appreciate the reminder when I'm in an escapist environment. I think it's cheap as a plot point. I think it's as cheap as having like a narrator tell you something's going to happen because everybody has feelings about it. And I think it's a really cheap thing to do. And I love Tom Hanks. So, and I love Sandra Bullock too. So that makes me hate to say that. But I just don't think this movie needs to exist. And maybe the message is really for Scott Rudin, the producer. I don't know. But I'm angry that this movie was made. And I know that that's a very personal feeling. But I guess what I've told you guys is the ones I don't want for Best Picture. So maybe we should get into Jill, bring it a little lighter. Let's talk about maybe what you do want for Best Picture.
Right. There's quite a number of them. I'm bringing them up right now. I just thinking about that September 11th. I was not in New York, so I didn't have that firsthand experience on that day. I did know, sort of by a degree or so, a few people, that were on the planes from Boston. So I agree that we do not have to, that's a cheap plot point. I'm just not sure if that particular movie, the one we're discussing, Extremely Loud and Incredibly Close, it seems that if we sat down and watched it, I'm wondering how much it really is a big plot point. And it might actually be a very small part of it. I think what you're saying is that they're using it to draw people in.
Well, it was in the trailer, so that's...
Yes, it was. And as they did, the movie's premise is that it starts by, him losing his dad. So I just think it seems like a fascinating, it seems like the rest of the movie might be really interesting with some very interesting acting with the different people that he comes across. So we'll have to report back on that one. But I agree that, we do not have to keep, for people who were there, for people who lost loved ones, for people who even, where you were, which is you were right in New York and you experienced it in the city, it's overdone, I'm sure.
Well, and I actually want to say on a lighter note, I'm kind of sad, even if I understand the reasons against it, that Harry Potter, the last Harry Potter film, Deathly Hallows Part 2, obviously I'm a huge Harry Potter fan. It is no secret. I am obsessed. I'm on all the podcasts. I'm on all the forums. I listen to all the podcasts. I'm a huge, big Harry Potter nerd. It's out there. But I was upset about its exclusion because it was pretty much the top grossing film of last year. Everybody saw it, and I do feel that sometimes the Academy, although I think it's important to highlight some of these movies that people wouldn't otherwise see, I do think it shows a certain exclusion from reality when the top selling movie of the year is not even included in the contenders for Best Picture.
Yeah. I agree. I mean, I don't know a lot about the Academy and how they make their decisions, but it seems that that's a pretty obvious exclusion.
Yeah.
Not even being a Harry Potter, big Harry Potter groupie. I like the books, but... So the Best Picture, there's a big, long list of them, and I'm going to just pick the one that I think is the best movie of the year and then let you do the same. We talked about a lot of them so far, and the others we didn't, maybe Hugo is another one, Midnight in Paris, The Tree of Life, and then along with The Artist, The Descendants, The Help, Moneyball, War Horse, and then Extremely Loud and Incredibly Close. So there's a big list, and I say War Horse, absolutely, just based on War Horse struck me as like almost like a Titanic-esque type of film.
I am shocked.
Yeah. Oh, you're shocked?
Yeah. No, keep talking. I want to hear every point of this, but I wanted you to know going into it. I'm shocked. Like, oh, please, tell me more. Because I've not heard anybody else really say that. Like, people, yeah, please, tell me.
Well, it's just that epic, I think it's that idea of that, like, epic historical kind of movie. That tugs at me. So... I did like The Descendants a lot. I liked the writing. I liked the acting. And, and Moneyball that was a great movie. But War Horse, and I have not seen every single one, but War Horse, just the epic I really like historical films, and I thought this one was very well done. And so I don't know where it is in contention because I haven't, been paying attention to exactly what's the favorite, but you may know, so I'll pass it over to you.
No, actually, I don't know what the favorite is, and that's been the big thing about this year. Is I looked down this list, and even the ones I've seen, I feel sort of meh about. Mm-hmm. None of these movies, like, even though, as I said, I really enjoyed The Help, I don't think it's a Best Picture. I think The Help is like best book to screen adaptation. You know, like, I'm sorry, but like, I believe I didn't think that Avatar necessarily should have won over Hurt Locker, because I thought Hurt Locker was a much better story. But I do think that that's the scale you need for a real best picture. And none of these stick in my mind as being like, yeah, man, that's the best picture of the whole movie. Midnight in Paris, I'm sorry, nobody saw that. Moneyball is like a great sports story about a guy who did something kind of unconventional and applied economics to sports. Good on him. Every team should be doing that, you know, like great. But it's not best picture. Descendants, lovely story about a very complex situation in a guy's life. Is it a best picture? Absolutely not. And we talked about the other ones, I feel like. But I almost feel like my negative approach, unfortunately, this year to the Oscars is just basically like, why these things? You know, what makes these better than all the movies people actually saw?
And you did feel that Avatar last year was the type that was just a big, you know, kind of more of a clear winner.
Well, and here's the thing about Avatar is like, yeah, Avatar is like everybody's favorite, although no one will admit it now. Everybody was talking about Avatar last year. You got to go see it. You got to go see it in 3D, or year before last, maybe it was. But, you know, everybody was talking about it. It was on everyone's lips. So it's appropriate that it was in the Best Picture category. Now, Cameron has a very special gift of when a movie comes out, everybody gets obsessed with it. And then a few months later, everybody gets sick of it and says they never liked it in the first place and makes jokes about it. I mean, Titanic, anyone? Everybody saw that 10 times in the theater and now says, oh, it wasn't that good of a movie.
But it was. Yeah.
You saw it 10 times in the theater. You obviously liked it at the time it came out, regardless of if you're sick of it now.
Right.
You know? And Cameron has a gift, and I appreciate that about him. He's very choosy. He chooses his projects by the things that interest him, and he has great instincts. And he's actually the reason that his ex-wife, Catherine, what's her last name, who directed The Hurt Locker, chose The Hurt Locker.
Okay.
Some people think it was a snub that she didn't thank him on stage. I saw him thank her at their seats, and so I don't feel that that was a snub at all. I think it was just appropriate, you know? It was her moment, it wasn't his, and I thought they handled that really well.
Yes.
But, you know, I mean, I don't know. I love the Oscars. I love the pomp and circumstance. I totally get into it. But with that comes some feelings of, like, you know, I always, every year, I'm like, you know, I get it. Yes, you should include some indie films that people should definitely see. But The Tree of Life, I didn't even go see it because everybody I talked to went to go see it was like, God, that was such a waste of my time. I want my 2 hours back.
Huh, right? Wow.
You know, like if nobody's seen it, if nobody wants to see it, if people see it and don't want to see it again, it's not a best picture.
Yes, that's true. You're right. That, you know what? We have just come up with our own criteria for best picture. If you see it and you want to see it again, that's a best picture. All right, Holly, that was great.
Awesome. Well, obviously we've gotten off the topic of Pet Chicks, but we wanted to prep a little bit for next week's Oscars talk. Hopefully we'll have some fabulous guests on next week. We're still sort of TBD on exactly which ones of our fabulous guests are going to be here. But never fear, we'll have some Oscar coverage for you and some exciting. Obviously, I'm going to want to talk about people's outfits and whether or not they were wearing a bra. So, you know, listen to that.
That'll be a fun one. So Pet Chicks was really very passionate and I just think a really nice thing to cover. And then next week will be our big glitz and glam. And I just want to give a quick recognition shout out to our Crash and Glass listeners. It seems like we have a great numbers, and if you promise to keep listening each week to our podcast, we'll keep bringing you great topics that women relate to and keep mixing it up, heavy topics, light topics, all of it, because we really enjoy this. So thanks for listening.
And I can't impress enough, like, if you're listening and you're loving the show, go to basenettv.com and click on Crash and Glass. Comment up a storm. Tell us what you want to hear. Tell us what you hate. Tell us what you love. And we'll give you more of what you love and less of what you hate. And we'll probably put your comment on the show. Email crashingglass@basenettv.com. Write in. Donate, please. $1 and you get to be a producer on the show. That's all it takes. You can create the content for us. So please write in, donate, and just go crazy. We'll do whatever you want. We're your dancing monkeys. We just want to hear from you.
Awesome. Well, great. Well, we're a wrap for this, and we will talk to you next week. Right, Holly?
Absolutely. Go get it, chick.